In the previous two sessions, we have talked about the basics of a perspective and how you can change the perspective if you, as a photographer, move your position and the position of your camera a little bit or a lot. And now we're going to talk about playing with the elements in a scene and how you can make the scene more interesting or convey something more or less by playing on the objects in the scene. Of course, the most easy way is if you have something which you organize yourself on a table or something like a still life. You can of course physically shift the objects. But we will see that even out there in the world where things already exist and you're not allowed to touch them, you can still play with a lot of parameters and position your objects relatively. So in the last two sessions we saw that by positioning yourself somewhere you can have quite interesting views on the world, like for example a top-down view, bird's-eye view, and also by playing on your lens. This is a perspective effect, but you can easily do it with the lens. You can have, for example, objects which seem cluttered together or more spaced apart. We're now going to talk about elements in the image, which can both be geometric elements like lines and such, or real objects. And we're going to talk about how the objects form positions on the sensor. So for example, here we see very quickly how a lens works. If you have a small short lens and the sensor close to the pupil, then you see a large area and you can zoom in on something by using a telephoto longer lens or positioning the sensor a little bit further, then you see only the small area. That's one of the key techniques you should know how to use. Okay, so lines and planes are two geometrical elements which form part of the image. We will talk much more about that in the composition videos, but knowing and controlling your perspective is a very interesting technique to make interesting photographic compositions, hence beautiful pictures. What makes the following interesting, for example? I have a quite nice image here of a seaside town in England. So we have indeed our lines towards the distance. We have also, more interestingly, curved lines, and they're also of a street which goes down. And we learned in the previous video that this depends on the angle of the objects, like this wall. We have here our lady, and you can play on the position of her by waiting a little bit when you photograph. So for example, you could be photographing just a big head and shoulders here, but that's not so nice, so you want to have her a little bit in the picture already. The sea is an interesting backdrop, so that's the distance, and you know this is a coastal town, and you have even more lines. If you add even more stuff, it would become a little bit chaotic maybe, but all these things together make this quite a nice harmony. So lines give you an idea of how things go in distance. First of all, the height gives you an idea how things go in distance, but also the conversions of lines. And you see there's some depth difference here in the road. Here also you see, in fact, these lines converge much faster than these lines, which means that the road is going down there, because they converge towards a point which is somewhere below the road here instead of on the horizon. That's what we learned in the previous courses. So lines are important cues. Here you have a curving line, so you can follow all the houses of this village, which was built on the top of a crater of a volcano. Weird place to build a village, I would say, but anyway. Same with this cave. Which lines do we have here? Well, we have of course our vertical lines upwards. We have our lines depth into the distance, but also these lines. In fact, we can make little cubes of all these three together, cubes filled with air. This one I found interesting because it's a slum somewhere in Africa, and they put their toilets at the beginning of the village, but it looks a little bit then like you're invited, you have your entry road bordered by all these toilets. other two compositions, the right one is maybe a little bit classical one, into upwards into the sky with another object in front of it. But this one is quite nice. If you shoot it like this, you see all the people in the sun next to the river. This one also, it's like shooting a landscape which goes into the distance, but now it goes upwards into the distance, towards infinity above your head. And you also see these nice shapes with protrusions. Classical one, stairs. Here again, a nice 3D view. You see the road, you see that there are discontinuities in height here. You can't see the stairs because we learned that they can be hidden from view if you have a certain angle relationship. But you do see the winding road. It's a very nice geometry, and the backdrop again. It gives you quite a good idea of what that city is. There can be lines in nature. Here you could still say, well, it's the farmer who did it, but here you have all these clouds. They are one after one, follow like queues. They're queuing for something, I don't know what, but it's quite interesting, and it follows lines again. So you can find lines anywhere, and you can use them in your composition. Lines will also give you an idea of angles. This is the cable car in Hong Kong. It goes quite steep, because here you see what the normal horizon is, and you see that everything in the cable car is slanted at a reasonable angle. It doesn't look that impressive on paper, but if you're sitting in it, it's quite impressive. Now we see that lines can be everywhere. They can be also curved in more complex perspectives and geometries. So we have here our linear line, and in a curved object that becomes a curved line. And that is because the reflection reflects equal angles compared to the orthogonal direction on this surface. And of course that orthogonal direction keeps turning. So you get ever bigger angles, and you get more and more of these far away objects clustered together at ever smaller angles, which means that you can see the entire world in a very small area. You also see them going backwards in the distance, because there's more area on these diagonal lines, which you will also see here. Here, of course, we have what is out of the picture, what is in front of us, where the viewer is now sitting. And we can even see here on the 45 degree angle that you can totally change the angle of the objects. And they're going away from us, but here you just see them in front of you. So that's quite interesting geometry also to work with. For example, here you can play games with it. What is this? Well, if we happen to have a metal cylinder reflecting, we can see it's a Mona Lisa. Here she has the right shape, here she has this deformed shape, and that's called an anamorphism. And that was quite popular when people didn't have a television yet. The same in a car, for example. Now you have all kind of irregular shapes, so the curvature keeps changing, and then you get these weird, quite interesting reflections. That's all perspective. Now a little bit more classic about lines. We have our lines, but we also have a triangular area here now. So we can start playing with planes. This is an example of a photo where the plane is an important compositional element, namely this triangular plane here. And it's not exactly half of the picture, because there's something going on here also, the beach, but it does form a nice bipartition of the image. Here we see that in general any quadrangle, so any rectangle for example, can get any quadrangular shape with any angles and sizes here, depending on where you stand, where you move a little bit more to there or there. If you stand here it will be more symmetric, trapezium. The same here in an old garage where the repair pit is full with water. And I photographed that a little bit more slanted for dramatic effect. Here again, an area of a table, but I use it now as a main element of the composition. I'm shooting over the table. I could have, of course, shot only the table, but I liked it to be together with the city and a little bit over here. But it forms a main planar element in the composition. The same here, the dredging. I found it interesting if I photographed it with this container, taking up a lot of the for the space in front, and also this big arm here. Here, of course, the area of the harbor forms a planar element in the composition. Same here, but a little bit more interesting, because just now the tension between the planar element of the walls, the city walls, also here, and where the sea can come, well, if it's high tide. Again, very planar composition. It's almost entirely made of the sea, but you can see both downwards and you can see into the distance, so that makes it an interesting photo. You have lots of things going on. This is a more classical one, of course. Again, a planar element. And you can make foodscapes. So in that case, you photograph your food together with the environment. You can also photograph only your food, obviously, but you can also do these kind of things. Here, the food is a bigger part, the majority of the area, and you just have a little bit of what's happening around. Here, the food plays a role, but there's also the environment. I found this red thing very interesting. And the food here is not such expensive food. I'm having that in the suburbs of a city. Some chicken, so it was interesting to photograph in such a manner there. Same here, you can go to the market. Now about the shapes of objects. So we talked about lines. Some particular lines are the shape of objects, because you want to photograph all kind of 3D things, but actually you're seeing just something what's inside here. These are reflections of light and color and such. And then you have the outline, the perimeter. But it's important to mind that, because here you have a kind of straight object, and if you shoot it like this, you don't realize that there's a nice curvature in this object. So you may want to choose your position of your object depending on what you want to convey. Now the third dimension, that's very difficult. So scale will play a role. And the depth, we want to see depth here. You see, of course, depth because of these walls. But you don't realize that there's also here a hole, and that this is quite much deeper, but we don't know how deep, because we don't know how big this is. We don't know how much we're seeing of this basement, of this cellar. So it looks almost like a flat coin, but it isn't. So what can we do? This is quite difficult to photograph, stuff like that. But you can do it a little bit better or worse. Here is another example. These mountains look kind of the same, although those mountains are much bigger than these. And to make sure that the point is clear, I photographed here just a plant, which also looks kind of the same as a big mountain. It has the same geometry. And that's, of course, because you can have a very big object, but which is far away, can look as big because it has the same angle on the photograph as a quite small object, which is much closer. So the closer you go to this bush here, to this plant, the bigger it will look, and it will start looking like a mountain. So how do you then make sure that you know a little bit of conveying how big these things actually are? Well, for the people who are watching this on a bigger screen, they will see that this couple of pixels here is a camper. And so it's a rather big van. And of course, these kind of images you may want to show as a big poster and not as something on your mobile phone. But that camper will give an idea of how high these mountains are. This is my bedroom. I'll give you a look into my own bedroom. Well, actually it isn't. It is a scale model. But you see that everything, again, could look like if you were in a real bedroom. Apart from the fact that it looks a little bit a little bit amateuristic, this microscopic furniture. So here again, size cues. You could use a tree if you have nothing better, but the tree can have all kind of shapes and all kind of heights. So it's better to have to wait until this motorcyclist goes by. And he will give an idea of how big everything is here. Gives you a much better idea. It can go wrong, of course. Here it looks like the guy is able to step over this building here, which looks like just adjacent to where he's standing, but actually if you look closer, it's much further than this rim here. And of course you will know that he will probably have this size. This is a multi-story building. But it looks a little bit strange sometimes, and it also depends on the size of your reproduction. It may look much more strange if you have a smaller reproduction than if you really are able to look all the way in the picture. Now, here you may be able to estimate the depth more or less because you have known objects. Well, it's difficult to exactly estimate how high we are because, of course, you can zoom in with your lens and such. So you know that you're at least above the roofs here. I have cut a certain cutout here, so it looks a little bit like we are on the roof level psychologically, but we could be shooting from a balloon, although the convergence here may also give somewhat of a cue. But at least we have somewhat of an idea still, like, I don't know, we may be here 20, 30, 40 meters or yards in the air. Also here, we know these houses, we know houses here, so we know that this is going to be like maybe 1 or 2 kilometers, like 1.5 mile in the distance maybe. So you know how far it is. But if you have unknown objects, it becomes really difficult because we don't know if this is a small mountain relatively close by or a big mountain very far away. If this guy gives a cue on what this here is, but we still don't know, unless we find a guy here, how high this part of the mountain is above this here. If this was the Caspian Sea, then we would be somewhere in a satellite. Direction. So there's a number of depth cues. We're looking at the 2D image and not the 3D world. In the 3D world we have the benefit of rotating with our eyes and also how the two different eyes have to micro rotate to look at a certain distance. We have of course disparity, the fact that our left eye is a little bit offset from the position of the right eye gives a small offset of both images, and we can calculate distance from that in our brain. We can move our heads. Even a guy who has only one eye can, by moving, still see more or less how deep everything is. But that we can't do with a still image. It's just a still image, and it is what it is. And if you move, it moves in its totality, and nothing else happens. So we must use other cues. So, for example, as I said, the perspective elements, converging lines, the ground plane is very interesting. You will have usually a foreground and maybe a middle ground, background. Occlusion, an object that is before another object must be closer, not necessarily knowing how close. The relative size of objects, if we have two objects of the same size, then we can estimate how closer one of them is. Now there's physical effects, as we will see also. There's lighting which we can use, and there's even people who project special patterns of lighting to measure accurately, like chessboard stuff and the like, to measure actually very accurately the 3D shape of something. The lens plays a role, for example the depth of field, and there's even a lot of psychological factors which we won't go into detail, but I'll give an example. And then you have of course pseudo perspective, like in cubism, and futurism is also very nice. The painting where you are behind a window, but it looks like the world is coming inside your room. So the ground plane, quite interesting here. We have this nicely sweeping ship here, and you see in the distance here also, because the street ends here, it even looks a little bit like this car is coming out of the picture. depending on how you show it, also that's the effect is more or less strong. Again, the ground plane, you know that these dragon heads here are at equal distances, and of course not in the 2D photograph picture, but that gives a very nice 3D effect again of this river. Same here, you have the queues of the guys, you have these repetitive units, you have the ground plane with elephants on it, so yeah. If you were looking at a purely 2D image, you would think that the guy was as high as the elephant, but probably the elephant is a little bit further away. But if these are elephants, you can imagine how big this fort is. The ground plane can of course fall nicely between mountains and such. Here we have again a situation with a lot of things in the foreground and somewhat of a ground plane, but here in the background we don't know exactly, this is Dracula's Abbey in Whitby, we don't know exactly how far it is because we don't know the size of it, but it has a certain distance because we also see it with less contrast in the mist. Occlusion. Object in front of other objects, cover part of the object. So you could even do without the ground plane, you could still see that these equally shaped things go in the distance according to a certain repetitive pattern, but of course it's much better cue to have the ground plane also. Also here we know that this arc of this gate is in front of this building and it kind of frames the building, but we don't know exactly how far the building is, but we can have somewhat of an estimate because this arc may be like the size of a car or maybe a truck. So we can get an idea of, this is probably not a huge house which is very far beyond, but yeah, you lose somewhat of the depth of course, it's just an arc and something behind it. Here also it's an arc and something behind it. You don't know exactly how big this temple is and how far. However, again, if you have the ground plane constraint, then you can see that it's probably maybe 20 meters, maybe 30 meters or yards, something like that. Here again, a nice depth in two directions, occlusions and all the like. It gives a nice 3D composition. Here I had the objects more closer together to show the various bridges, one after the other. They squeeze a little bit together. Again, lots of complexity, lots of layers of people, very crowded in the distance, a float of carnival. So, yeah, it again gives you also some impression of being there among the crowd and of distance and depth and such. But also because it's cluttered together, it's not such a clear distance effect as, for example, ground plane. This is an example of the physical reasons why you see depth, and painters had to understand that if they wanted to make realistic paintings. So if you have, for example, water droplets in the air, they're gonna reflect some of the light, not towards you, towards somewhere else. So the objects in the distance, they're not gonna be so visible. They're gonna be very low contrast, very hazy. And also they will become more bluish. And we have the same if there's dust particles. This is in Amman, in the desert. It's not that wet there, but also the dust can scatter and you can have these nice yellowish. So again, you see, it's very beautiful that, yeah, here the contrast could have been somewhat higher maybe, but here it's really nice to have just a silhouette. Here you see the blue haze very well, and things are not blue in here in front, but they become progressively bluer the more you go to the distance. And you may not want to compensate for that because, well, it looks normal. And of course, these physical effects, they happen everywhere. They also happen in the water, for example. And there it goes much faster, even on a sunny day. You can't see the stairs here anymore. I'll just give a couple of examples of how light can be used for showing the shapes and the distances and such of objects. Here you have, for example, the long shadows in the distance of a low sun. And you see these very long legs because of the perspective contraction and a small body. So light typically goes down as a square power, so it goes quickly down from where it is and it becomes dark, and you can use that aspect to, with certain light spots and such, show the shape into the distance of certain objects, and even the shape itself. So I said there are also mental aspects which you can play on. Here I made this shot because it has all these nice distances, all these nice products up to the wall here, all the way in the back. Now we do see these distances, but if you make everything blurred, then you don't realize these distances anymore. You see it up to here more or less, and this looks like almost a uniform one plane in the distance. And that is also what you may want to do. If this is distracting, you just want to show very well the whole geometry here, and this is just filling. But you can also do other things. Here I did a geometrical transformation where I stretched the outer parts compared to the inner parts, which are more compressed, and then you see a more into the distance, a different angle here of the middle part, and in the distance you see a huge wall now suddenly, and that gives a totally different depth impression than what you had here. And again, if you use certain special filters, again, this doesn't have much distance anymore now. And you can use this as a depth of field kind of behavior, either with your lens aperture or as a post filter. And it kind of, as I said, it kind of becomes one distance, one plane in the distance, instead of, because it's all blurred, you don't see so well anymore that there are several of these things anymore, of these positions, shelves. Compared to here, there's a clear gradient of, you see nicely what happens one thing after the other. So you could play on that, you could say it's way back in the distance, at infinity almost, just some wallpaper kind of area, versus it's all part of the same shop. Here we have a nice sharpness and we see everything in the shop, and here we focus mostly on the foreground objects and not so much on background. That's of course a technique which photographers like to use many times, where they're showing a model, a person for example, and you want to see, you want to focus on the person and not be distracted by everything in the back. So it may be that this is still too complex, that there's lots of color going on, so you could make it even more uniform or darker, or things like that can help to, and the darkening can be done either by switching off the lights, the lamps in the shop over there in the back. If you can't do that, you can do it of course in software, and then you will focus obviously even more on the foreground objects, but you want to have something in the back. Here there's nothing in the back, so this is just almost a black vacuum, and then you see the object kind of in an infinite space. And of course, if it's a black bottle, you may need to do some rim lighting, otherwise you will only think you will see a label here. So another thing you can do with lighting is the so-called limb effect. That light will come from a certain direction and it will become progressively darker if you go away from direction. Here we have illuminated the objects straight in front and they look kind of flattish. Of course, you may know that the arm is a round thing, but it could be just as well a flat rectangular cubical thing, or even a flat thing. Here I have illuminated from the left, and then you see this gradient from more light to progressively darker if you go outside of a limb or any round shape like this bottle. I've done it with a non-texture and a texture object. It also happens here, but because the brain focuses more on the texture, on what is visible here, what's happening here, it is less focusing on the light. Photographers have to learn, have to teach themselves to look at light also, and not just that meaning of objects. But here you can see it clearly, so I took this uniform object, so you can see also here there's a bright part of the face and a dark part of the face. There can be all kinds of cues which can compete with each other and sometimes give very strange effects. So you may think that this bottle is bigger than this one. And if you don't, maybe we should add some pillars, and then the bottle here is half a pillar and here it's much higher than a pillar. So all these cues can work together and sometimes also contradict each other, and then you get nice funny pictures. False perspective and perspective jokes. Here you see that points can fall on a line, so what this guy wants to do is pretend that his friend is as high as a giraffe. Well, he can do that if this arm and this arm fall on a line with the camera, so he should put his mobile phone down there. Same one here, you can put your hand in front of a building and then it looks like you're picking it up. Same one here, it looks like this thing is standing beside the car. Now I want to talk about the 3D structure of scenes. So you have here Aït Ben Haddou in Morocco, you have all these houses. It looks a little bit like a planar thing, but it also should look a little bit like a dome, because you have the houses behind each other, on top of each other, ever higher on the mountain. So this is a shape you want to have. Here you see it much clearer, because you go, instead of photographing from this side where it stacks on top of each other in the distance, you see it now growing. Really growing from the side, so it goes upwards and you get the 3D structure compared to the sea, which gives a very nice appearance of this area. Also with the images in the houses in the back, you get a good idea of what's happening there. Here another structural thing. I've photographed in such a manner that you see two regions in the composition, the indoors and the outdoors. Here I wanted to show both the streets in both directions, but also the island that this building is, and the people who live here all in this building compared to another building. So you have a 3D structure of the building, but you also have it separated by the streets. Here you have the 3D structure of this isolated group of buildings. Here you have the 3D structure of the city. It would have looked a little bit different, for example, if I had stopped photographing over here, because then you would have two buildings bordering this area. Now you see that you really have a building here and more buildings and such. But in any case, you have the buildings nearby encompassing the structure in the distance of some further buildings. This has a very different look from, for example, the following city image, where you have more an overview. You don't even have to be so high, but because there are these isolated buildings, it gives a very different look than if you are in between the buildings, like in the previous picture. The same street, standing a little bit closer or further, gives a totally different look. Here the street, everything looks like more a backdrop. It's maybe a little bit less inviting, and here it looks like more a cubistic stacking on top of each other of all the objects. Here it's also more about the street, and here it's more about these houses. So you see that even changing your position by a couple of meters and your composition, and so you can get a totally different impression of a city. The objects themselves, how do you position them? Yeah, obviously the basic thing, if you don't want to do something really special, is just make sure that your basic object is kind of in the middle, not exactly necessarily in the middle. In composition theory, but you're looking straight onto it on its own level and you have a nice interaction with it. But in fact, if you have one object compared to a background or two objects compared to each other, there's all kind of things you can do. You can put your eye or camera over here and then you will see different positions, or you can stand here and then the guy will overlap with the tower, which can be nice, but sometimes it's also something a no-no, because the tower may grow out of his head and that may be weird sometimes. So for example, here with the lions, I could go down on my knees and have a position where they nicely synchronize, where they nicely collineate. It was a very low, not so comfortable position, but it can be done. Same here with the lion, you can photograph him in front of this arc, where it's not even very conspicuous, or you can have him framed by the arc, just by choosing another position, and then the relative positions and sizes of the objects will change, and you will get a totally different photo. So here we show how this seagull can be photographed from two directions, just by moving around it. So here we see it against the city, here we see it against the boats, whatever you like the most. Of course, also the shape of the bird will change depending on where you stand, because here you see it head on, here you see it nice from the side. You may choose which one is more important for you, but you can always wait till the bird moves a little bit and then maybe have both the combination of the bird shape and the background shape. Now here it becomes more interesting. This is not a frog which can jump very high, it's actually also a balloon, and I was waiting because I saw the trajectories of the balloons, they were converging. So if you then go position yourself in the right spot and wait for maybe 10 minutes or something, then you can get this nice image as if there's a frog jumping on the balloon. This one is a little bit more simple. This horse-shaped fountain, it looks like it spits here in the open window over there. These are the kind of funny things you can do with perspective. Here it's a little bit less obvious, less a joke, but still I positioned the guy so that he has a line of sight connection, a composition technique with the guy over here. You could of course photograph it in many different other ways. This one is a classical one. You see all these people strangely. The fun here is that they seem to push against the air, but of course if you stand at the position of the photographer, then you will see that it will look like he's pushing or holding the Tower of Pisa. Here this is a parade, and of course again you position yourself and you use your focal length so that you can see some of the participants and some of the environment, and you can optimize that. Another example here is using the tree to recognize the forest. So this is it for today. I've given some examples. There are of course thousands of other examples. But next time we will talk about more special things about perspective, like panoramas, where you're gonna stitch together several different perspectives, and fisheye lens and such. So thank you for watching again. I'll try to upload some new movies on new topics. I hope it was interesting for you and a lot of inspiration for your own work. It takes some time to make these videos, of course, but each time I have some spare time, I will be making a new one. So have a regular visit and tell your friends who are also interested in photography to visit to query for Meneer Photo Professor. Thank you very much, guys. Bye.